Okay, so what we will study that is known as creeping flows, meaning that the Reynolds number of this flow is much less than 1. Let us first write down the governing equations. So we know that the Navier-Stokes equations In this particular case, we have written down P as the modified pressure. And in this equation, we have also assumed that the fluid is Newtonian. Let us try to write down the dimensionless equations in the following form. So let the dimensionless velocity be the velocity divided by a characteristic velocity, uc. Let the characteristic length, so any coordinate x, bar will be x divided by lc, where lc is a characteristic length. Let time be dimensionless as time divided by t characteristic. Okay. So let's see what we obtain. So from this particular equation, we will have rho uc, right? And the first term will be del u dimensionless by del t dimensionless, but because t appears here, there will be a tc appearing over here. Plus, there will be another uc, because this uc we have taken out. The gradient will lead to a 1 by lc over here. Okay, so there will be u dot nabla of u. These all will be dimensionless. On the right hand side, we will have minus pc by lc of grad p, where pc is sort of the characteristic pressure. So p bar is equal to p by pc. And finally, we have mu uc by lc square, nabla square u bar. So this is the governing equation in a dimensionless. So we have not made it completely dimensionless. Let's see. Let's take uc by lc outside. So we have rho uc square by lc. But if I take uc by lc outside, I will have lc by tc uc appearing in this particular term. So this plus is equal to minus pc by lc plus mu uc by lc square. So such kinds of things we have already done in other analysis, but we'll see where this takes us. Let us divide everything by mu uc by lc square. Let us divide everything by mu uc by lc square. So on the left hand side, we have rho uc square by lc multiplied by lc square by mu uc times lc divided by tc uc times del u bar del t bar plus u bar dot nabla bar u bar is equal to minus pc by lc multiplied by lc square by mu uc, the dimensionless gradient of pressure, plus the viscous term, the dimensionless viscous term. Okay, so what is this particular combination of terms? This particular combination is nothing but the Reynolds number. So this uc cancels with 1 uc and this lc cancels with 1 lc. Essentially, it is rho uc lc by mu. Essentially, this is Reynolds number. So the prefactor for this term in the bracket is Reynolds number. What about lc by tc uc? essentially LC by UC divided by TC. So what is LC by UC? LC by UC is sort of the characteristic time of advection. And TC is sort of the characteristic time of the entire phenomenon. So suppose, I mean, in many cases they will be equal, but say you have a problem in which you have a membrane such as this. Suppose this is your intestine or something. And in this you want to analyze the motion of things. Okay. So the characteristic time scale is the forcing time scale of the intestine. So this membrane will oscillate with a time scale of say omega. So let's say that this profile of the membrane is given by A sine x minus omega t because it's a traveling wave. So this represents a traveling wave. Not omega t, this will be x minus tt. So essentially this argument is kx minus omega t, where k is the wave number and omega is the frequency. So in this particular case, the characteristic time will be 1 upon omega. But the time in which the effect of advection propagates in the channel over a length LC, suppose the LC is this length. So the time taken for velocity to sort of propagate its effect over the length LC is defined as LC by UC. So it's a ratio of the time taken for something to evolve over the length LC through advection divided by the characteristic time scale of the problem. So this particular number is called as the Struhal number. Rather, the inverse of the Struhal number. So Struhal number S is defined as the characteristic time of the problem divided by the advection time and this is equal to TC divided by LC by UC. So under these substitutions, the final equation resembles RE times 1 upon S del U vector del t plus the advection term is equal to minus PC by, let us see what the advection is. This term becomes PCLC by mu UC times the gradient of P plus the dimensionless viscous term. What about the choice of the characteristic pressure? What about the choice of the characteristic pressure? So, in many of our problems, we know that the choice of the pressure can be rho uc square, or the choice of pressure can also be mu uc by lc. So, the observant student will say that this particular choice is called as the inertial scaling, while this particular choice is called as the viscous scaling. So the question is, which scaling is appropriate? Which among these two scalings is appropriate? So let us say, for argument's sake, that PC scales as rho UC square. In this case, let us see what this last term becomes. So the last term is PC by mu UC by LC. So rho UC square divided by mu UC upon LC. So UC cancels out. We have rho UC LC by mu. So this particular term under the scaling of PC as rho UC square ultimately becomes Reynolds number. So under PC scales as rho UC square. The equations are Reynolds number times 1 by S times the temporal term plus the advection term is equal to Reynolds number times minus gradient of P dimensionless plus the viscous term. So let us consider the creeping flow limit. What is the creeping flow limit? It is RE becoming 0. So one can never have RE equal to 0 because there will always be some length scale over which RE will be finite. So we can only choose RE to be much smaller than 1, and the leading order assumption of this is that RE equal to 0. So if you recall elements of regular perturbation, we can say that at the leading order, RE equal to 0 represents the base behavior of the entire equation. And the analysis of that state will allow us to sort of get a gross estimate of how the system is evolving, at least at the leading order. So what happens to this particular equation at RE equal to 0? So we have 0 equals 0 plus the viscous term, this. So the other equation, let us not forget, is always the continuity equation. So here we have two sets of equations. So essentially this is three equations, because Nabla square U vector equal to 0 is comprised of three components: Nabla square U equal to 0, Nabla square V equal to 0, Nabla square W equal to 0. So we have three equations coming from here, and this particular equation is del U del X plus del V del Y plus del W del Z. Let us not forget that every variable over here is a dimensionless variable and everything should be a bar. So now we have four equations. We have four equations, 1, 2, 3 and 4. We have four equations but only three variables. The variables being U, V, W. So obviously the system has become over constrained and we may not be able to obtain a consistent solution for this subjected to the appropriate boundary condition. We all know that pressure must always appear as a variable in the system. So if pressure must always appear as a variable, let us see what it means. If pressure has to appear, meaning this particular term has to be of the same order of magnitude as this particular term. So this particular scaling, what does it yield? PC LC by, I'm just writing the equation down again on the right hand side. So on the right hand side we have PC LC by mu UC times the dimensionless gradient of pressure plus the dimensionless viscous term equals 0. So if these two terms are of to be the same order of magnitude, then PC should be of the same order of magnitude as mu UC by LC. Essentially, it implies that the pressure must be chosen from a viscous scaling. And if this is the case, the governing equation becomes Reynolds number times 1 by Struhal number times the temporal term plus the advection term is equal to minus gradient of pressure dimensionless plus the viscous term, which is this. And in the asymptotic limit, Reynolds number tends to 0, we have minus grad P plus Nabla square U is equal to 0, along with the constraint on the velocity of incompressibility. So now we have four equations and four unknowns, and this is an appropriate scaling for creeping flow. So So these equations are known as the Stokes equation or the creeping flow equation, and form the basis of a lot of analysis. Would we have been able to arrive at this particular scaling through the inertial scaling as well? Let us go back to the inertial scaling. This is the inertial scaling. Let us focus on the right hand side. If we focus on the right hand side, we have Re times minus gradient of pressure plus Nabla square U is equal to Reynolds number times the left hand side. So in the limit Re tends to 0, if the pressure vanishes, then obviously the choice of the characteristic pressure is not appropriate. Meaning we have to rescale pressure. So let us define P cap as Reynolds number times P bar. If we choose this, this particular term gets modified to minus the dimensionless gradient of P cap plus Nabla square U equals Reynolds number times the left hand. So if Reynolds number now tends to 0, the equation becomes minus gradient of P cap plus Nabla square U is equal to 0. Let us see what then P cap is. So P cap, let us recall, is Reynolds number times P bar. So P cap equal to Reynolds number times P bar, where P bar was chosen from the inertial scaling. So it is Reynolds number times P divided by rho UC square. What is Reynolds number? It is rho UC LC by mu times P divided by PC divided by rho UC square. So rho gets cancelled. One of the UCs get cancelled. So it becomes PC by mu UC by LC. Essentially telling us that even if you choose a wrong scaling for the pressure, if we choose a sort of implicit scaling for pressure, this is also called as the implicit pressure scaling because it is not dependent on viscosity. So if you choose the implicit scaling also, you can always rescale the equation to account for the presence of pressure in the equation so that this particular term does not vanish. And that particular rescaling yields this appropriate scaling that we have chosen as the viscous scale. So in this particular mini lecture, we have seen that the dimensionless equations reduce to this particular equation, and they are sort of the base behavior in the limit of Reynolds number tends to 0. And Reynolds number tends to 0 is a very important paradigm for many industrial processes such as coating industry, the entire biomicrofluidics industry. So this includes pharmaceutical, this includes all sorts of reagent analysis, analytical chemistry. And so on. It also forms the basis of several DNA testing paradigms. So processes such as DNA electrophoresis or gel electrophoresis, these are used in forensics and various DNA tests. So these equations form the basis of many processes. Almost all kinds of processes going on in your body is some sort of a low Reynolds number flow, which essentially manifests itself in an upscaled manner in the form of various operations which we see. So in the next lecture, we will see some manifestations of this particular equation. So this particular equation, you can see, is linear in velocity, and it will sort of go against many of your preconceived notions which are developed in the case of higher Reynolds number fluid mechanics. So notions such as drag acting on an object or the lift acting on an object, which you have notionally understood, say from the throwing of a cricket ball. So those are higher Reynolds number processes. And what happens to the drag and lift at low Reynolds number is a completely counterintuitive phenomenon. So with this, we stop this lecture over here. I will be there on my Discord server for any questions. Thank you.